completed all the 17 chapters and stepping into the last chapter, which is called as the, which is nothing but the summary of Bhagavad Gita. So entire Bhagavad Gita is summarized in this chapter. Moksha Sannyasa Yoga, it's also called in English, Prabhupada calls it as conclusion, the perfection of renunciation. So we'll start our session with prayers. Om Jnanatimirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakhaya Chakshurunmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Namo Vishnupadaya Krishna Prishthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhaktivedanta Swaminiti Namine. Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarine Vancha Kalpatarubhyasya Kripa Sindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha. Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shri Vasadi Gauravakta Vrinda. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Mukam Karoti Vachalam Pungam Langayate Girim, Yat Krapa Tamaham, Vande Shri Guru Dina Taranam, Paramananda Madhavam, Sri Chaitanya Mishwaram. Hare Krishna. I hope my voice is loud and clear, and it's audible to everybody. Okay. So, can you just recollect what we did last Sunday? What did we learn in the last chapter, 17th chapter? Any quick revision? What is the main theme of the previous chapter?
Face.
Yeah, what did Omkar say?
Face.
Okay,
faith. Austerities, charity, enjoy of everything.
Okay, faith, austerities, charity, enjoy of everything. Correct. Okay, so we discussed about faith. Basically, Arjuna asked a question to Krishna. What will happen to those who faithfully follow some other path and not the Vedic path? Right. So they perform their own kind of invented rituals. So what will happen to them? So that is the question asked by Arjuna, and then Krishna answered, yes, these people reject their scriptures and they follow their own path, so they will not get success. So there are three kinds of faith, Krishna said. Trividha, Bhavati, Shraddha. Three kinds of faith, Satviki, Rajasi, Tamasi. And then he went on to explain different divisions of kinds of activities, basically yajna, dana, tapak, karma, based on the faith they have, right? So Krishna described about food in three modes, right? So we discussed that. So what are the characteristics of food in sattvaguna? What will happen by eating the food in sattvaguna?
Prabhuji, it gives us more bhakti.
Okay.
And we also saw that we should sometimes we shouldn't accept sattvic food if it is not offered to the Supreme Lord.
Okay, we should try to eat sattvic food which is offered to Supreme Lord. So what are the, we discussed about six things which sattvic food does to us.
It increases the age, okay. Energy, health, happiness, okay. Love.
Okay, Ayu, Sattva, Bala, Arogya, Sukha, Priti, Vivardhana. I could not send the quiz for the last chapter because I was very busy this week, but I'll send it this week. So that's why I'm taking this revision so that we can just recollect those points. Okay. So what is the effect of food in passion? Rajasic food, what will happen by eating that?
Distress, misery.
Okay.
Diseases.
Dukkha, Shoka, Amayaprada. Dukkha, Shoka and diseases. Okay, so what are the food in Tamaguna?
It should not be taken, the food with sharing. No, non-vegetarian.
Okay, non-vegetarian food is tamoguna. Even food which is stale, putrid, and decomposed, that is all tamoguna food. So food in three modes. Then austerity of, you described austerity, austerity of speech, austerity of mind, austerity of the body. Right? So these are the things. Then he discussed about, of course, this is very important actually, austerity of speech, how to speak, what not to speak. So that very, very important art. So we should try to follow that. Anudvega karam vakyam satyam priyahitam chayat svadhyaya abhyasanam chayiva vangmayam tapuchyate. So we have to follow these different rules before we speak. So there's a comment coming here. Pungent food is, okay. Pungent food is rajasic. And food cooked before 3 hours, that is tamasic. Okay. So then Krishna described three kinds of charity. What is the charity in Sattuguna? When you say that, when do you say that the charity given is in Sattuguna? What are the main characteristics of charity in Sattuguna?
Prabhuji, it should be related to Krishna work.
Okay, so you're telling it should be given to Krishna.
Yes.
That becomes spiritual. That is topmost charity. But one level before, below that, what is sattvic charity?
Prabhuji, we should not accept anything in return.
No return. Yes. Anupakarini. No return. Don't you not expect anything in return? I have given, so I want something in return. But in passion, you expect return. Okay, I have given this much. I also want something in return. And then tamoguna, the charity in tamoguna is given in to a adesha kale patrecha.
Unworthy
person for a wrong cause. Like we discussed about giving charity of flesh or drinks. So that is tamasic. So in this way he says, and finally he says that every activity, any activity you do, sattvic, rajasic or tamasic, it is tainted with some kind of karma. So that's why, how to get freed from this karma? How to get freed from the offenses or imperfections in all these activities?
Prabhuji, we have to purify it by offering to the Supreme Lord.
Okay, you have to offer it to the Supreme Lord. And here Bhagavad Gita 17th chapter mentions that one should chant Om Tat Sat. So by chanting Om Tat Sat, one can overcome all the imperfections. So that was the conclusion of the 17th chapter. So we also generally, we may not chant Om Tat Sat all the time, but we chant Hare Krishna Mantra, which is not different than Om. So in this way, we should try to remember Krishna in all the activities, and then the activity becomes perfect. So that's the meaning of this. Okay. So then comes to the 18th chapter of Bhagavad Gita. So I'll start screen share. Okay. So conclusion, the perfection of renunciation. So that is the topic for today. So today's acronym is SMILE. S stands for summary of Karma Yoga, which is first 18 chapters. So in this chapter, Krishna mainly summarizes the entire Gita, and then he concludes by giving very clear direction to Arjuna what is to be done. So summary of karma. In reality, there are 5 causes which bring success in any activity. The individual soul, the body, the senses, endeavor, and ultimately the super soul. Since we are only one of the 5, we should never have an overvalued estimation of ourselves. So this is one of the main important concept of Karma Yoga. Don't think you are the doer. There are many other doers. You are also part of it. We'll discuss it in detail in the chapter. And modes of nature. So Prakriti's gunas, that is described 19th to 40th. here Krishna further describes three categories of knowledge, three categories of action, karma, jnana, three categories of determination and happiness. So three. So he describes about in 15 verses three categories of these things: sattvic, rajasic, and tamasic. So then he says that everybody is ultimately, when they are in this conditioned body, they are controlled by three modes: sattvic, rajasic, and tamasic. Nobody can avoid it. As long as we have this body, we are controlled by these modes. So we cannot avoid. So we should work according to the modes. So that's the ideal worker. One need not artificially imitate another man's duty, but rather embrace what is natural and inborn. So that is the third point. And love of God. So it's the most important point. The conclusion of this chapter is given in the conclusion of whole Gita is given between verse 56 to 66. Where you'll find some of the instructions repeated again. And one of the final instructions, 18.66, the final instruction of Krishna that comes here. End result. Result of hearing Bhagavad Gita and what we should do after hearing Bhagavad Gita. That's given in the last 12 verses. By hearing and studying this conversation with such favorable temperament, one perceives the spiritual dimension as a tangible reality and his life becomes exciting and wondrous at every step. Okay. And Krishna also says that one who has read this Gita should also spread this Gita. So that comes in the later part of this, the last part of this section. Okay. So this is the summary of this chapter. And there are many subsections. So that's why I didn't make the shloka-wise summaries, but I can show you in this word file the breakdown of the different chapters, different shlokas of this chapter is like this. So first 12 verses give the summary of karma section, and then next six verses give summary of jnana section. Then summary of the yoga ladder is given here: karma yoga, sakama to nishkama karma yoga. And then there is from nishkama through liberation to devotional service. So nishkama karma yoga, moksha to bhakti. So ultimately it ends with bhakti in shloka number 55. Bhaktyamam abhijanati, that's what he says. And then work in pure devotional service, more confidential knowledge, surrender to the super soul, the most confidential knowledge of all, become a pure devotee of Krishna. And then preaching and studying Bhagavad Gita, that comes here, this four verses, preach and study. Arjuna is firmly fixed. Arjuna says after hearing Bhagavad Gita that all my doubts are vanquished. I have no more doubts. Now I will fight. And at the end, Sanjaya predicts that surely Pandavas are going to win because Krishna is there. And Arjuna is there. Yatra Yogeshwarah Krishna, Yatra Partho Dhanurtharah, Tatra Shrir Vijayo Bhotir Dhruvani Tir Matir Mama. So that final declaration is given by Sanjaya, and which is the last verse of Bhagavad Gita. So in this way, Bhagavad Gita ends here. So we will start with the chapter 18. So today's session may be a little longer than usual because it's a very, very long chapter. Hare Krishna. So we'll not read all the verses. I'll just select some important verses or verses which are important to understand this chapter. So those verses I'll select and then we'll recite those. And then I'll give a summary of most of the sections. Okay, we'll not get into detail. But the fourth part, which is the part where Krishna is giving the most confidential knowledge, that part we'll try to elaborate. Okay, so who would like to recite with me today? Maybe today we can have two people. For the first half, there can be one person who recites after me. And then for the second half, we'll have another person reciting. So who would like to recite in the first part? Okay, Anuradha Mahajan is ready, raising her hands. Okay, we'll give her a chance. So kindly repeat. Arjuna Uvacha. Sannyasasya Mahabaho. Tattvam Ichhami Veditum. Tyagasya Cha Rishikesha. Pruthak Keshi Nishudana.
Arjuna said, O mighty armed one, I wish to understand the purpose of renunciation and of the renounced order. O killer, the Keshi demon, master of the senses.
So here the important word is Keshi. Keshi Nishudana, the killer of Keshi. And two words of Krishna is Rishikesha and Keshi Nishudana. Keshi represents demon. So Krishna is the killer of all demons. And here doubts in the mind are also called as demons. So the doubts also have to be destroyed. So Madhusudana, in the second chapter, Krishna was addressed as Madhusudana. Here Madhu also is a demon. So that is also demon of doubt. So demon of, weakness of the heart. So when Rishikesha is there, when Krishna is present, Rishika means senses. Isha means the master. So when the master of the senses is present, when the killer of the demon, Keshi, is present, so very surely all the doubts of Arjuna will also be vanquished. So similarly, if we have association of Krishna and his devotees, so very soon all the doubts will be vanquished and faith in Krishna will arise. So that's the meaning of this shloka. So question of Arjuna is, what is sannyasa and what is tyaga? So these two things he had asked. So we'll see the answer. Shri Bhagavan Vacha.
Shri Bhagavan Vacha.
Kamyanam Karmanam Nyasam.
Sannyasam Kavayo Viduhu.
Sarva Karma Falatyagam. Prahustyagam Vichakshana. Please read.
The Supreme Personality of Godhead said, the giving up of activities that are based on material desire is what great learned men call the renounced order of life. And giving up the results of all activities is what the wise call renunciation.
Yeah, so there's subtle difference between tyaga and sannyasa. Sannyasa means giving up activities based on desire. Kamyanam karmanam. I want to do something because I like it. Giving it up, that's called sannyas. Okay. So, and tyaga means what? You do something which you like and then give up the result. So that's called as tyaga. So giving up results of all activities is called tyaga by the wise. Right? Sarva karma falat tyagam, prahu tyagam, vichakshanah. So intelligent people call this as tyaga. So your voice is echoing, seems two devices using a speaker. Please check. Oh, is my voice clear?
Prabhuji, when there's one more person
speaking, okay, my voice is not echoing, right?
No, Prabhu.
No, okay. Okay.
Prabhu, I will change. Till that time, you can give chance to someone else.
Okay. Yeah, maybe you can use a earphone, then there'll be no echo. If you're using some sound system, external speaker, then it may be a echo. Difference between tyaga and there are certain sacrifices to perform to attain good sun, to attain elevation to the higher planets, but sacrifices prompted by desire should be stopped. So if I have a desire for something and then I do that activity, that is not sannyas. Sannyasa means what? He will not do anything on his own. He will do only what Krishna wants him to do. That is the stage of sannyasa. Okay. So that's very high stage. So here Krishna then says, Tyajyam doshavadityeke karma prahur manishinaha yajnadana tapakarma natyajyam iti chapare. Even if the yajna dana tapak karma may have some faults, but still one should not give it up. That's the meaning of this. This is told by some intelligent sages. Manishinaha, the great sages, intelligent ones, they have said that never give up yajna dana tapak karma, because these four, they will purify us. Even if they are mixed with fault, a devotee should not give up these four things. One should do it for Krishna. He says here. Yeah. Here. Oh, best of the Bharatas. Now, here my judgment about renunciation. Oh, tiger among men, renunciation is declared in the scriptures to be of three kinds. So, three kinds of tyaga will be described here. Okay. So we'll recite this verse, fifth one. Are you ready, Anuradha Mataji?
Yes, yes, Prabhuji.
Yajnadana tapakarma.
Yajnadana tapakarma.
Natyajyam karyam evatat.
Natyajyam karyam evatat.
Yajnodanam tapaschaiva.
Yajnodanam tapaschaiva.
Pavanani manishinam.
Pavanani manishinam.
Is it?
Acts of sacrifice, charity, and penance are not to be given up. They must be performed. Indeed, sacrifice, charity, and penance purify even the great soul.
So these things, they purify us. Yajna, dana, and tapa. So one should never give it up, although they may be having some faults in them. Because when we are performing, we may not perform it perfectly. But one should still do those activities. Right? So there are many purificatory processes for advancing a human being to spiritual life. So there are Vivaha Yajna, okay, which is very important. So one may say, oh, Vivaha, marriage is so troublesome. I don't want to marry because after this, I have to take a bungalow, I have to work hard, I have to maintain the family. So who will get into all this trouble? Let me not marry. Like that one may say. But it is recommended for those who cannot renounce. Okay. So there are some people who take sannyas, who don't need marriage. And if they are fit, then they can stay without marriage. But for most of the general population, marriage is required, because they cannot stay. If they don't marry, then they'll commit some adultery. So that's why it is recommended. Okay, even though it is troublesome, do it. So Vivaha Yajna is important in that sense. And there are some people who artificially renounce and make the show of being a renunciate. But because their heart is not pure, they may end up doing some sinful activities. So that's why it is said that one should not give up Yajna, Dana, and Tapa. These three are very important. And especially for those who are beginners in spiritual life, one should practice all these things. But if some prematurely gives it up, then it will be trouble. Like Prabhupada used to say that there was one Prabhupada disciple who asked Prabhupada, Prabhupada, I want to go to Vrindavan and chant all day. I don't want to do any work, but I'll chant all day and I'll purify my heart. Prabhupada said, no, you do your service, you do your work and chant 16 notes. That's okay. He said, no, Prabhupada, I want to go to Vrindavan, Radhakunda, I'll sit there and chant with all the holy place, Govardhan, Yamuna. So it's so wonderful. So he went, he did this for about 2 months. And after that, again, all the material desires awakened, because he was not fit. He was not qualified to do that kind of bhajan in renunciation. So that's why after some time he left Vrindavan. And again went back to work. And this time, he didn't get any job, he went into petrol pump and there he was filling petrol. And one devotee came there to fill petrol in his car and looked at him. He said, hey, this person seems to be familiar. Then he very closely looked at him, and that person was trying to hide his face because he knew the devotee. So then he said, "Hey, you are that fellow. You had gone to Vrindavan. You are chanting there. What happened?" So he said, "No, I chanted for all my life. In 2 months, I chanted so much that I don't have to chant anymore. So I have come back to work now." Like that he was telling. So what happens if somebody gives up prematurely? Then he will not be able to maintain it. So that's why it is recommended that one should continue doing yajna dana tapa, and then this will purify that personality. So that is recommended here. So all these activities should be performed without attachment or any expectation of result. They should be performed as a matter of duty. O son of Pratha, that is my final opinion. So we should do these things as a sense of duty. Sometimes we may not like it, and sometimes it may be difficult for us to do, but still one should do these activities that will purify us. And what is the contamination from which they will purify us? They will purify us from the thought of being the doer, doership mentality or enjoyership mentality. Those mentalities will be purified from our heart. So that's what Krishna says. So this tyaga is also in three modes. Let's see what are these tyagas in the three modes. Yeah. Prescribed duties should never be renounced. If one gives up his prescribed duties because of illusion, such renunciation is in the mode of ignorance. Tyaga in the mode of ignorance. And tyaga in the mode of rajoguna is because it is kaya klesha bhayat. Why it is very troublesome for my body? Like for example, fasting. Why it is so troublesome for my body? I'll never do fasting. So if somebody gives up because it is troublesome, then it's called as rajasam. Right? So anyone who gives up prescribed duties as troublesome or out of fear of bodily discomfort is said to have renounced in the mode of passion. Such action never leads to the elevation of renunciation. Okay. Now see the third one. Sattvika mataham. Sattvika tyaga. What is that? Can you please read this?
Yes, Prabhuji. O Arjuna, when one performs his prescribed duty only because it ought to be done and renounces all material association and all attachment to the fruit, his renunciation is said to be in the mode of good.
Yeah. See here, very interesting definition. Prescribed duties must be performed with this mentality. It's not that we should give up work. We should give up wrong mentality. That is called as proper renunciation. So here, what is the mentality? Let's try to understand. When one performs his prescribed duty only because it ought to be done. Okay, I am a Kshatriya. Let me do my duty. What is my duty? To protect the citizens. To keep the people away from trouble. So that is my duty. Let me do it. But he thinks he is detached from the result. See here? He renounces all material association and all attachment to the fruit. Okay, this is very important. If the Kshatriya wins the battle, he feels, okay, Lord, because of the will of the Supreme Lord, I could win. He doesn't become proud and he doesn't boast and then he takes a credit. See, I did it. No, he never says, I did it. It's because of the grace of the Lord I could do it. It's because of many other factors I could do it. So that's what he thinks. So that kind of renunciation is said to be in the mode of goodness. So we have to develop the quality of renunciation, mentality of renunciation, not just renounce the work. Right? So even in ISKCON, there are many sannyasis, many brahmacharis who are serving in the temple and doing a lot of activities. They don't work. Right? Like I don't have office job. I don't work. I don't earn money. There are many other sannyasis who are just dependent on Krishna. They're traveling all over the world and preaching Krishna consciousness. So they have given up material work, but they have not given up Krishna's work. Right. So one of the devotees are telling here that the ISKCON Brahmacharis work more harder than even corporate work, corporate offices. So because he sees devotees working hard, harder than others, but for Krishna. They work for Krishna and they feel dependent on Krishna and they give up all their work, the results of the work to Krishna. So in that sense, it becomes spiritual. Even the grahasthas in our moment. So if you ask them, which is the busiest day? They will say weekend. Weekend is the most busiest day, even for the ISKCON grahasthas. Why? Because so many programs, you know, they will attend some programs or they'll give some programs or they will organize some program or they will do some seva. So in this way, they are busy doing service. Right? Weekdays, they may be working outside in the office and earning for their livelihood. But when they get time in the weekend, they spend whole day in temple and doing their service. So in this way, both grahasthas and brahmacharis, they can cultivate the spirit of sannyasa. Not just give up work, but sannyasa means give up the mentality of being the doer and give up the results to Krishna. That is actually sannyasa. So Krishna is telling that here. So then Arjuna is maybe thinking in his mind, okay, you're telling give up the fruits of this activity, but when the fruits come, what I should do? Like if I do something wonderful, or if you do something wonderful, you will get some glorification, some appreciation. That's a kind of fruit, right? And suppose you are a student and you write your exam and you get good grades. That is a fruit. So Arjuna is asking, what to do if the fruits come? For that, the answer given is. So that again is verse number 12. Yeah, can you please read this?
For one who is not renounced, the threefold fruits of action, desirable, undesirable, and make, accrue after death. But those who are in the renounced order of life have no such result to suffer or enjoy.
So basically, it means that if you think that you are the doer, then you will get either good results or bad results of that activity. Like if you did some good, if you think I did that good, you will get good results in the future life. And if you did something wrong and you think because of me it happened, then what will happen? Because of the doership mentality, you get the karma also. But those who have renounced the doership mentality, okay, I'm just acting on behalf of Krishna, then such a person will never get any good or bad reactions. Right? Ubhe sukrata duskrute. He'll become freed from both bad and good reactions. So that is the meaning of that. Why is it so? Krishna explains in next two shlokas. He says that there are five factors for success in any work. Understanding these five factors, a devotee automatically renounces. Because he feels that I am not the doer. There are four other factors also. Panchayatani mahabaho karanani nibhodame. Sankhye kritante proktani siddhaye sarva karmanam. So, hey Arjuna Mahabahu, there are five karanani. Okay. The five factors. Karanani siddhaye sarva karmanam, for the purpose of making the work perfect, for giving the results of the work. There are five factors. So, what are those five factors? Let's hear in the next shloka. So kindly repeat this verse. Adhishthanam tatha karta.
Adhishthanam tatha karta.
Karanam cha prithak vidham.
Karanam cha prithak vidham.
Vividhastha prithak cheshta.
Vividhastha prithak cheshta.
Daivam chaivatra panchamam.
Daivam chaivatra panchamam.
Yeah, there are five factors mentioned in this shloka. Kindly read this.
Yes. The place of action, the performer, the various senses, the many different kinds of endeavor, and ultimately the super soul. These are the five factors of action.
Yeah. See, these are the five factors of action. Adhishthanam tatha karta. Adhishthanam means the place where you are doing the work. Karta means the doer, one who is doing the work. And who is the karta here? The soul, atma. Because atma is desiring to do. So that's why it's called karta. Karanam, the senses, right? The five working senses and the knowledge acquiring senses. They are the karanas. Cheshta, the effort which is exerted in that work. Like a student, he exerts the effort of studying. A Olympics champion, he'll exert the effort of running, right? Physical exercise, like the cheshta. And daivam, so it is sanction of the Lord. So without the sanction of the Lord, I cannot get any success. These five are the factors. The place, the doer, the karta, the senses, the cheshta, and the daivi. So daivam. So these five factors lead to success. So atma or we are only one factor. And all other factors are controlled by the Supreme Lord. The place is not under our control. The senses are controlled by prakriti. They're not in our control. Sometimes the senses may misbehave, right? Or they may malfunction. I want to see, but if the eyesight is taken away, I cannot see. So the karana. And cheshta means the endeavors. And then daivya. So these five things are the factors for success. So understanding this, one should develop detachment. One should develop renunciation or sannyasa. So that's what is mentioned here. Okay. Some people ask, who creates destiny? Destiny is created by my desire and the actions done according to my desire by the sanction of prakriti. Okay. So the destiny is made by me, but is awarded by daiva. Sometimes we want success, but still we cannot get success. Like for example, two students in the same college, same class, they are studying and they're writing the same exam at the same time in the same classroom. And the question paper is set by the same teacher, but still both of them get different results. Doesn't it? Everybody doesn't get the same result. Everybody gets different results. Why is it so? Yeah, because other factors are different, right? Because his destiny is different. His karma is different. His senses are different. His the Paramatma's sanction is different for each one of them. So in this way, one gets different results. Another example, let's suppose the floor is oily. In the kitchen, suppose oil is spilled and three friends are walking in that kitchen and they slip and fall on the ground. All three of them at the same time slipped on the same floor and all three fell on the ground. But the result was different. One person got a scratch. Another person got a fracture, right? Another person, he got hit on the head and his blood was coming. So in this way, same action, same place, but different results because their karmas are different. So in this way, these five factors lead to some result in the activity, okay? So that's what we have to understand from this. So after telling this, five doers, he says that although there are different factors for success, then why am I getting the reaction? Okay, everybody should get reaction. Paramatma also should get reaction. Prakriti also should get reaction. And I also should get part of the reaction. Suppose some sinful activity is committed, then I'm a part of it. I'm not wholly responsible for it. Then Krishna says, no. Although the work is done by all these five factors, you are responsible because you desired. Because you desired to commit this mistake, you will be punished. Like for example, if there are five thieves and one person is the leader of the thieves and he makes the planning, today we'll steal like this, today we'll murder that fellow and take his property. Now, among the five, when they are all five are caught, the person who is the mastermind, he will be punished, isn't it? He'll be punished more than others. So here also, the soul is a desirer because he desired, and according to his desire, the Paramatma sanctions, and then Prakriti acts and the senses act. So, but the reaction is coming to the desirer, the Atma. So the doership mentality, when we have this doership mentality, I am the doer. So then we become responsible for the reactions of our action. But if I just act on behalf of Krishna, following his desire, then I am not responsible for any good or bad reactions which come. This is the point which Krishna is trying to teach Arjuna since beginning. And a lot of discussion happened about this. Do your duty on my order for my pleasure. So that's what is Krishna's conclusion. So here also in the end of this, in the last chapter, Krishna is concluding. Arjuna, don't think you are the doer. Just act on my behalf. Fight now. So that's the conclusion which Krishna wants to drive into Arjuna's heart again. So it doesn't mean that we should become irresponsible. We should be responsible in our life and try to do activities in the spirit of detachment. So that's what we have to learn. Like if you're an office goer, working in a company, and do your work, and whatever results come, you offer it to Krishna. So do your best and leave the rest to Krishna. Don't think that we are the doers. The job is given by Krishna. The boss above me is appointed by Krishna. The salary which he's giving is sanctioned by Krishna. So whatever result is coming from that work, let me offer it to Krishna. So let me offer it, the results, for my Krishna consciousness and the enhancement of my family. So in this way, we have to Krishnaize everything in our life. So that is the conclusion of Karma Yoga. So from shloka number 18, Krishna starts the topic of jnana, where he summarizes jnana, which he had spoken before also. So let's try to read that section, verse number 18. Yeah. Jnanam jneyam parijnata.
Jnanam jneyam parijnata.
Trividha karma chodana. Karanam karma karteti. Trividha karma sangraha.
Knowledge, the object of knowledge, and the knower are the three factors that motivate action. The senses, the work, and the doer are the three constituents of action.
Yeah. So here the constituents of motivation of action and the constituents of action. See, the senses do the work itself, and the doer. They are the three constituents of action. And the knowledge, object of knowledge, and the knower are the three factors for motivation. So three kinds of jnana are also there, according to the knowledge, the action, and the performer of action. So the three kinds of knowledge will be given here. Yeah. Please read this.
The knowledge by which one undivided spiritual nature is seen in all living entities, though they are divided into innumerable forms, you should understand the mode of goodness.
Yeah, so that knowledge which helps you to see the soul in everybody's heart, that is knowledge in the mode of goodness. Okay, so whether he may see a Prabhupada writes here, is the first line. A person who sees one spirit soul in every living being, whether he be a demigod, human being, animal, bird, beast, aquatic, plant, okay, possesses knowledge in the mode of goodness. So this is knowledge in mode of goodness. So we are practicing this knowledge now, which is Bhagavad Gita, which is transcendental, but it the prerequisite is at least one should come to the mode of goodness. Then one can see Krishna. But at least let us try to see the soul. So that's what this shloka is telling. So if somebody is seeing the soul in the heart, then that's the mode of goodness. And mode of passion is, he sees only varieties of the body. Oh, he's a cat, he's a dog, he's a bird, he's a human being. See, in this way, he differentiates between species, and he cannot see that same similar soul is present in each of the bodies. There's a mode of passion, knowledge in the mode of passion. And then knowledge in the mode of ignorance. And that knowledge by which one is attached to one kind of work as the all in all. without knowledge of the truth, and which is very meager, is said to be in the mode of darkness, tamoguna. He has a very limited knowledge, narrow understanding of life's truths. So that is called as mode of darkness. So in this way, three kinds of knowledge is described here. So after this, three modes, Krishna goes on to explain three kinds of action, sattvic, rajasic, and tamasic actions, which starts from verse number 23. Yeah, please read this.
That action which is regulated and which is performed without attachment, without love or hatred, and without desire for productive results is said to be in the mode of goodness.
So whenever goodness comes, there is no fruitive results. Karma phal ki ichha nahi hai. So that is mode of goodness. And he is not averse nor attached to that work. He can do anything. He's not attached. Okay, I will do only this kind of work. If there are some devotees who say, I will do only puja, seva. I will not do washing seva or cleaning seva. So it means what? They are rajasic because they want, they are attached to a certain kind of activity. They are not ready to any other activity. So that is rajasic. Tamasic means what? He can do. Sattvic means what? He can do any kind of service for Krishna without any discrimination. That is sattvic. Yeah, and Rajasic is told here. Yeah, please read this.
But action performed with great effort by one seeking to gratify his desire and enacted from a sense of false ego is called action in the mode of passion.
Yeah, action in the mode of passion means he is acting out of ahankara. I am the doer and I want to enjoy the fruits of this work. So that's called as rajasic. Yeah. And tamasic?
That action performed in illusion, in disregard of scriptural injunctions and without concern for future bondage or for violence or distress caused to others is said to be in the mode of ignorance.
Yeah, ignorance means they will not follow the Vedic rituals, that they will do something on their own. So this is the, yeah. So I'll show the summary here. Yeah. So knowledge in mode of goodness means he sees all beings equal. And sees different types of souls in different living beings, that's passion. And sees no soul, only sense gratification, that is ignorance. Action, goodness is regulated by Shastra. Passion, effort is unregulated, overwhelming desire to enjoy. And ignorance, disregard Shastra, performs in illusion, performed in illusion, causes violence and distress to others. So this is a summary of these two. Knowledge in three modes, action in three modes. Now let's get into the next part, which is described here. Intelligence in three modes. Okay, three kinds of doers in three modes will also come. Yeah, verse number 26. Please read this.
One who performs his duty without association with the mode of material nature, without false ego, with great determination and enthusiasm, and without wavering in success or failure, is said to be a worker in the mode of goodness.
So here, see this photo. This karma in mode of goodness. They will do whatever is niyatam, sangarahitam. So whatever is prescribed for them, they will do. Like Brahman is teaching, Kshatriya is fighting to protect Dharma, and there is Vaishya and Shudras. So they are doing their respective works according to prescription. But there are workers in mode of passion. You'll see here. You're working in the factory, you're working with heavy metals. See, yattu kama kamep suna karma. With a desire for some result, they'll do work to get some result. So that's called as kame karma. So that's mode of passion. Kriya sa sa ahankarena sa va punaha. So they will do with ahankar, that I am the doer. Kriyate bahula shaya bahula yasam. Tadrajasam udaharatam. So with great effort, they'll perform this work. They're called as mode of passion. Yeah. Okay. So we're reading 26th verse. Yeah. Okay, so worker in three modes. Sorry, previously it was action in three modes, work in three modes. So here, mukta sango na anaham vadi, without any ahankara. Dhriti utsaha samanvitaha. Siddhi asiddhyo nirvikaraha. Karta sattvika uchate. Devoid of detachment. See, Arjuna is going to fight here now. Devoid of detachment, without any ahankara, with great enthusiasm. So that is mode of goodness. Mode of passion, he is working for results. See, Duryodhana and Dronacharya. So Dronacharya or Bhishma it is. So Duryodhana is telling them, fight, because I want to fight and I want to enjoy. So that's called as Rajasik. And Harsha Shogan Vitaha. Sometimes he'll become dejected when he gets bad results, but he will become ecstatic when he gets good results. So that is passion. And Karta in ignorance, 28th verse, it's telling, Ayukta Prakrita Stabdha Shato Naishkritiko Alasa. Alasa means laziness. See, this fellow, this fire, building is on fire and is sitting on an easy chair and trying to blow off the fire. This is called Alasaha, means laziness. Such a person is called worker in mode of ignorance. Visharga Dirga Shruti Cha Karta Tamasa Uchade. Vishadi. Vishadi means he does a lot of lamentation. So that is. Dirga Sutri means who procrastinates. And sometimes there is a habit of procrastinating. We have to do something today, but we postpone it. Tomorrow I will do. So there's a mode of ignorance. Okay. So after telling about mode of three modes of doers, then it has three types of intelligence. Satviki, Rajasi and Tamasi. So three kinds of intelligence are also mentioned here. I'll just give a summary. Yeah. So 30, 31 and 32. 30th verse is goodness can distinguish right from wrong. Passion, understanding or intelligence in passion cannot distinguish right from wrong. And intelligence in mode of ignorance mistakes right from wrong. So these are three things. So goodness means what? Okay, this item is good. I will use this only. Or I will do this activity only. So he knows clearly what is right and what is wrong. Passionate person cannot distinguish right or wrong. So sometimes he will choose the wrong thing, thinking it to be right. And ignorance person, he is firmly convinced that wrong thing is right. And is firmly convinced that the right thing is wrong. So ulta, opposite of goodness. Like a goodness person doesn't even touch alcohol. But a person in ignorance thinks, oh, this is like nectar. How can somebody live without it? So that is ignorance. And passionate person, he is wondering, oh, alcohol, some people say it is good. Some people say it is bad. So he is wondering what to do. So that mode of passion. So these are three types of buddhi or intelligence in the mode of goodness, passion and ignorance. Then he tells three kinds of determination. Yeah, three types of determination, goodness, passion, ignorance. Determination and goodness, unbreakable determination to achieve liberation by sense control. That is goodness. Means what? Suppose a devotee in goodness, he will never break any rules and regulations. He'll strictly follow. Even if there is provocation, he will not succumb. So that is called as goodness determination. And determination in passion, unbreakable determination to achieve sense gratification, economic development and mundane religiosity, dharma, artha and kama. They want these three things. And they will work very hard with determination for this. That is passion. And ignorance person cannot go beyond dreaming. He will always keep dreaming. Ek din aayega when I will become rich. One day will come and I will be successful. One day I will pass. So that is dreaming. He is not certain about the result. So that's called mode of ignorance, determination. So devotee should cultivate mode of goodness, determination. So we should, like for example, we should chant every day. We should attend programs regularly. So having determination for this, that's called mode of goodness. So after telling three types of determination, he tells three types of happiness now. Happiness are also three types. Goodness, happiness in mode of goodness appears like poison in the beginning and later becomes nectar. But passion, happiness in passion, it appears like nectar in the beginning and then becomes poison. And happiness in ignorance, only an illusory hope for nectar, poison from beginning to end, arises from intoxication and sleep. So these are the three kinds of happiness. I'll read the 37th verse, because it's interesting. 37th verse says, kindly repeat this. Yattadagre vishamiva.
Yattadagre vishamiva.
Agre means in the beginning. In the beginning, it appears like poison. Pariname amrutopamam.
Pariname amrutopamam.
Parinam means at the end, it becomes amrita, nectar. Yetat sukham sattvikam proktam.
Tat sukham sattvikam proktam.
Atma buddhi prasadajam.
Atma buddhi prasadajam.
Yes. So here it is said, such happiness, tat sukham sattvikam, such happiness is called sattvika. Atma buddhi prasadajam, it will make the body and the mind happy. So this is mode of happiness. For example, getting up early in the morning. For some people, it is so tough, it is so poisonous. But when you start doing it, you feel happy, right? So in the beginning, it is difficult. So changing to sattvic diet, in the beginning, somebody may think, oh, okay, how can I give up so many other things, chocolates and coffee and tea? But in the end, result will be happiness. It's so nice to be away from those bad habits. So in this way, poison in the beginning and nectar at the end. So how many of you have this experience? How many of you getting up early? How many of you get up before 5? Anybody before 5? Okay. We have one hand. Okay. Arshav Agarwal. Very nice. Can get up early. Dhiraj also. Okay. So two of them get up very early. That's wonderful. How many of you get up before 6? Between 5 to 6. 5 to 6. Okay. Now I think more hands will be up. Okay, we have 3 hands up. Okay. Mohit, Suvash and his family and Rishi. Okay. And how many of you get up between 6 to 7? Okay, now most of the hands are raising. Okay. Okay. Anybody after 7? After 7. Okay. One few hands are up. Okay. So for those who are getting up late, actually, one should get up quite early in Brahma Murta between 4:30 to 6. So initially it may appear difficult. How can I get up at 4 o'clock or 5 o'clock? It's very difficult. But once you start doing it, you'll start liking it. You feel the morning time is so valuable, so important. We should use that morning time for our spiritual activities. So initially, it may be troublesome. But the end, parinami amrutopamam. So I have been getting up early by 4 o'clock since last 15 years. Before that, I used to get up by 6 o'clock. But since last 15 years, it's 4 o'clock. And so wonderful. Initial 3-4 years, it was a little difficult. Because in the daytime, you'll feel tired. You'll feel exhausted by evening. Because we have that habit of sleeping late and getting up late. But once you rotate your clock and do it for a long time, sleeping early and getting up early, you will feel the nectar, amazing, this wonderful lifestyle. So that's how you'll feel. So you can try to make this and change in your life. And you will see that all your spiritual activities will start giving better. It will start feeling better also. It'll give better results also. Okay, you can try this. First, at least try to get up before 6. And then within a couple of weeks or months, you can try to shift it before 5. Right? That should be good enough. So in temple, we get up quite early. But in homes, it should be good enough before 5 o'clock. So in this way, three kinds of happiness were also described by Krishna here. So then, after describing three kinds of happiness, Krishna goes on to describe that he says, Natadasti prithivyam va divi deveshu va punaha sattvam prakriti jair muktam et yad evhisya tribhir gunai. He says, nobody in this world is free from the effect of these three modes. Means everybody is controlled by these three modes, sattva guna, rajaguna, and tamuguna. And they are forced to act according to the gunas. And especially they are categorized into four categories. Sattvic people, rajasic people, and tamasic people. And according to the modes or the gunas which they have acquired, they will act accordingly. So they are called as Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, and Shudra. So these four categories are categorized like that. So shloka number 41 tells about what are the duties of a Brahmana because of his association with Sattaguna. So let's read this. So Brahmanam Kshatriya Visham means Vaishyas, Shudranam Chaparantapa Karmani Pravibhaktani Swabhava Prabhavair Punaihi. So these four categories of people, they will engage in work according to their Swabhava, which they have acquired because of Gunas, Prakritair Gunaihi, the association with the Gunas. Okay, let's read about Brahmanas. Let's recite this shloka. Would anybody else like to recite? From now onwards, somebody can raise your hand. Anuradha Mataji recited it up because a long chapter will. Okay, Omkar Tupe is raising hand. Okay. Shamo Damastapashaucham.
Shamo Damastapashaucham.
Shanti Rajavamevacha.
Shanti Rajavamevacha.
Gyanam Vijnanam Astikyam.
Gyanam Vijnanam Astikyam.
Brahma karma svabhavajam.
Brahma karma svabhavajam.
So the qualities of a Brahman are mentioned here. Shama means peacefulness. Damaha means self-control. Shama means mind control. Dama means self-control. Tapaha means austerities. So Brahmanas generally do a lot of austerities, fasting, puja, and all those things. Shaucham means purity. They should be clean. They should not have any impurities in their heart. That is Shaucham. Kshantihi, tolerance. Arjavam, honesty. Eva, certainly. Cha. Gyanam, vijnanam, astikyam. Gyanam is knowledge. Vijnanam is wisdom. Realized knowledge. They don't know. They just don't have theoretical knowledge, but realized knowledge. Theoretical knowledge you can get from books also. But realized knowledge you will not get. So that realized knowledge is here. Astikya means faithfulness. Astika means one who has faith in God or religious person. So that's called Astikya. Brahma karma svabhavajam. These are the duties of a Brahmana. See, anybody claims himself to be Brahmana, you should ask him, do you have these 8 qualities? If you have, then okay. You are a qualified Brahmana. But if one doesn't have, then one should develop these qualities to be called as a Brahmana. Okay. Then the next verse. Here the qualities of Kshatriya are mentioned. Can you repeat? Shauryam Tejo Dhritirdaksham.
Shauryam Tejo Dhritirdaksham.
Yudhe Chapya Palayanam.
Yudhe Chapya Palayanam.
Danam Ishvara Bhavascha.
Danam Ishvara Bhavascha.
Kshatram Karma Subhavajam.
Kshatram Karma Subhavajam.
Please read this translation.
Heroism, power, determination, resourcefulness, courage in battle, generosity, and leadership are the natural qualities of work for the Kshatriyas.
Yeah. So they should be very extremely influential and powerful. So then only they can be the leaders of the society. And not just powerful, but also they should have wisdom. So that wisdom should be guided by Brahmanas. So Kshatriyas are always subordinate, or they should be subordinate to Brahmanas. Then only they can do their duty properly. Because they have power, but they don't have wisdom. So they should borrow the wisdom from the Brahmanas. So Brahmanas get Kshatriyas, and Kshatriyas protect the Vaishyas. Because Vaishyas have wealth. So that is next verse. Krishi Goraksha Vanijyam. You are muted, Omkar.
Krushi Goraksha Vanijyam.
Vaishya Karma Svabhavajam.
Vaishya Karma Svabhavajam.
Krishi Goraksha Vanijyam. Krishi means agriculture. Goraksha means protecting the cows. And Vanijyam means doing business based on what they are growing in the land and from the cows. These are the three qualities. So Vaishyas are the people who earn money. Kshatriyas don't earn money. They will collect taxes. Have you seen any king working and getting salary? Kings never got salary, but they collected tax. So they'll collect tax from Vaishyas and keep it in the treasury and use it back for the service of the society. So, and they'll take the facilities. The king will take the facility for whatever is required to do the service. So in this way, collect tax and engage in service of the society by constructing dams and making facilities like roads and electricity like that. So that's why even the government also nowadays collects tax. But what happens in between, the politicians eat. So they are lobby, they are, there is corruption. So that's why they are not Kshatriyas. So here Kshatriyas loot very purely. So Brahmanas also don't earn money. They don't take any salary. They live based on charity. So they give knowledge, and whatever charity comes, they accept it. So that is the quality of Brahmana, Kshatriya, and Vaishya. Let's see the quality of Shudra. Paricharyatmakam karma.
Paricharyatmakam karma.
Shudrasya api svabhavajam.
Shudrasya api svabhavajam.
Paricharya means serving. A Shudra will serve Brahmana, Kshatriya, and Vaishya in whatever way they require. So they'll do anything for them. So this is called as Shudra. So means he's an obedient person. Shudras are obedient. That is a good quality. But nowadays, people are outcast. They're not obedient. So they do something on their own. They cheat the master also. They work for the master and cheat the master. So that's not a Shudra. So there's outcast. So in this way, nobody is free from the effect of these three modes. Everybody is under the control of these three modes, and they have to work accordingly. If they work accordingly, they'll be happy. If somebody has a Brahmanical nature, do a Brahmana's duty. Don't try to be a Kshatriya or a hero. If somebody is a Kshatriya, don't try to be like a Brahmana, a Sadhu. No, you cannot stay. So that's why Krishna is urging him here, urging Arjuna, you fight, you are a Kshatriya. You use your skills in serving me and don't give it up. Because it's better to do your own duty imperfectly than doing somebody else's duty perfectly. So that Krishna says in the next section. So verse number 47. Yeah, please repeat. Shreyan swadharmo vigunah.
Shreyan swadharmo vigunah.
Paradharmat swanushtitat.
Paradharma swanushtitat.
Swabhavaniyatam karma.
Swabhavaniyatam karma.
Na kurvan naapnoti kilvisham.
Kurvan naapnoti kilvisham.
Please read.
It is better to engage in one's own occupation even though one may perform it imperfectly, than to accept another's occupation and perform it perfectly. Duties prescribed according to one's nature are never affected by sinful reactions.
Yeah. So if you are a Brahmana, if you are doing Brahmanical duties, you are safe. But if you try to change your propensity to something else, it's very difficult. He says, generally one cannot change one's swabhava so easily. It is only possible by great mercy of devotees. Otherwise, generally we act according to our swabhava, a Brahmanical or Kshatriya or Vaishya or Shudra. So accordingly, we should engage our propensity in Lord's service. Okay. So, while doing one's duty, there may be some imperfections. Like Kshatriya, Prabhupada says here. For a Kshatriya or administrator, there are so many abominable things. A Kshatriya has to be violent or kill enemies. Sometimes a Kshatriya has to tell lies for the sake of diplomacy. Such violence and duplicity accompanied with political affairs. Accompany political affairs, but a Kshatriya is not supposed to give up his occupational duty and try to perform the duties of a Brahmana. Right? If a Kshatriya thinks, oh, I have to kill, I don't like violence, I don't want to do this violence, so better let me become a Brahmana and stay like a sadhu. No, it's not going to happen. Even if he stays like a sadhu, sometimes he may become angry and take his sword and kill others and then become sinful, because Brahmana is not supposed to kill others. So in this way, he'll commit sinful activities. So that's why Krishna is urging, telling Arjuna that please don't give up your duty. You fight for me. Right? So similarly, a Brahmana may also think, oh, there are so many duties which I have to do, but sometimes I have to commit some sins. Like for example, here, even Brahmanas who perform different types of sacrifice sometimes must kill animals because sometimes animals are sacrificed in ceremonies. Okay, sometimes there are Gomedha Yajnas, Ashwamedha Yajnas, which are done to test the efficiency of the Yajna. If the old horse is sacrificed, it gets a new body, then the sacrifice is successful. But if it doesn't, then he's tainted with sin. But Brahmana cannot say, hey, I'll not do this because I may get sinful karma. No, he has to do. And he has to try to do it perfectly. See, Vaishya also, businessmen sometimes have to tell lies. This is the best product. My product is the best product. Please take. Because for making a living, he might have to say something like that. So just because of this one reason, he should not give up his work. He should continue to do this work. So that's what Krishna is telling here. Shreyan swadharmo vigruna paradharma sunishtita. So because every work is accompanied by some smoke. Sarva ramba hi doshena dhumena Agnir Ivavrata. Just like when you light fire, smoke will come. A lot of smoke or a little smoke will come. Similarly, when you are doing your prescribed, which is called as karma, don't get afraid. Natyajet. Sahajam karma kaunteya sadosham api natyajet. Even if there are doshas in your duty, don't give it up. Continue your duty because that is good for you. At the end, you will get purified and you will get success. So that's what Krishna said. So in this way, Krishna is going on and on. And then he comes to the section. So he says that one should be detached. One should follow Niskama Karma Yoga. And one should give up all the results of one's work. And then goes on. And then comes to the section where Krishna gives a process. That there are some people who attain moksha or liberation by the process of unattached work. So that's being told here. So this is similar to what was told in 6th chapter. It's almost similar. Can you please read this? Omkar?
Yes. Being purified by his intelligence and controlling the mind with the determination, giving up the objects of sense gratification, being freed from attachment and hatred, one who lives in a secluded place, who eats little, who control his body, mind, and power of speech, and who is always in a trance and who is a detached, free from false ego, false strength, false pride, lust, anger, and acceptance of a material thing, free from false proprietorship, and peaceful, such a person is certainly elevated to the position of self-realization.
So this was the path followed by Jnana Yogis or Ashtanga Yogis, very similar to which is mentioned in the 6th chapter of Bhagavad Gita. So after following that stage, he will come to the stage of Brahma Bhuta. So this is a very important verse. Next sloka. Very often quoted by Srila Prabhupada. Let's read this. Brahma Bhuta Prasannatma.
Brahma Bhuta Prasannatma.
Nashochati na kankshati.
Nashochati na kankshati.
Samasarveshu bhuteshu.
Samasarveshu bhuteshu.
Madbhaktim labhate param.
Madbhaktim labhate param.
So Brahma Bhuta stage it is called. A stage of Brahman stage. Where he is happy. Prasannatma. Na shochati. He doesn't lament. And nor does he desire. Na akankshati. Nakankshati. He doesn't desire anything material, nor does he lament for lose of something. Okay, suppose he loses something, he will not lament. Because he knows it is temporary. I am soul, separate from these metal bodies. Samasarveshu bhuteshu, and he sees everybody equally because he sees Atma. He has come to the stage of Atma, so he sees Atma in everybody's body. And such a person who is on this Brahma Bhuta stage, he attains bhakti, mad bhaktim labhate param. So interesting this is. So first, one should come to the stage of understanding that I am not this body. Then one can practice bhakti. So Srila Prabhupada elsewhere says that bhakti is practiced by purified senses. Our eyes and the legs and the hands and everything should be purified, spiritualized. Then actually we can experience bhakti. So when we come to the Brahma Bhuta stage, then we can transcend to bhakti stage. So that's what this shloka tells. So you come to the stage of Atma. That's why Prabhupada will again and again in his lectures emphasizing, you're not this body or a soul. You're not this body or spirit soul. So he hits on it again and again and again. And then a person can act on the platform of bhakti. So next shloka glorifies bhakti. So from this shloka onwards, till shloka number 66, very important shlokas. We'll try to recite most of them now. Bhaktya mam abhijanati.
Bhaktya mam abhijanati.
Yava nishchasmi tatvatah.
Yava nishchasmi tatvatah.
Tato mam tatvato jnatva.
Tato mam tatvato jnatva.
Vishate tadanantaram.
Vishate tadanantaram.
So he says that bhaktya mam. Arjuna may ask, okay, after attaining bhakti, what is the benefit of attaining bhakti? And Krishna says, but from bhakti, you can understand me. Tattvata. And when you understand me, you will come back to me. So that's the benefit. So then Arjuna may be asking, but this is a very difficult process, you know. First, you should follow all these rules you mentioned in the 51st verse to 53rd verse. And then come to the Brahman stage. And then come to understanding you. So it's so difficult path. But how do your devotees understand you? That's what he asks. Is there any other shorter path? Then Krishna says, yes. Sarva karmanyapi sada.
Sarva karmanyapi sada.
Kurvano madvyapashrayaha.
Kurvano madvyapashrayaha.
Mat prasada davapnoti.
Mat prasada davapnoti.
Shashvatam padam avyayam.
Shashvatam pada avyayam.
Now, please read this.
Though engaged in all kinds of activities, my pure devotee under my protection reaches the eternal and imperishable abode of my grace.
Yeah. So one should do kurvano madvyapashrayah. Sarva karmani api sada kurvano madvyapashrayah. Always do work for my pleasure. And by my mercy, you will come to Padam Avyayam, to the spiritual platform. So that's what he says. So then he says, Chetasa sarva karmani mai sanyasya matparah buddhi yogam upashritya matchitta sadatam bhava. So he's telling that always be mat chittam. Always think of me in your heart. And when you think of me in your heart, you will surely reach the highest destination. So then, next shloka, this very famous verse, which is similar to the verse spoken in verse number, text number, I think 6 in 12th chapter, 12.6. Matchitta sarva durgani.
Matchitta sarva durgani.
Mat prasadatarishyasi. Atachetvam maha ahankaram. Nashroshasi vinanshasi. Yeah. Please read.
If you become a conscious of me, you will pass over all the obstacles of conditioned life by my grace. If, however, you do not work in a such consciousness, but act through false ego, not hearing me, you will be lost.
Matchitta sarodurgani. If you think of me always, matchitta sarodurgani matprasada. Durga means difficulties. Durga means very, very difficult tasks. Sarodurgani matprasada tarishasi. By my mercy, you can overcome all difficulties. Atha chet tvam ahankaran. You give up your ahankara. Nashrosasi. If you don't hear me, vinankshasi, you'll be destroyed. So Krishna is very clearly telling here, Arjuna, listen to me. Don't do anything on your own. Just listen to me, he's telling. So, can you read this?
If you do not act according to my direction and do not fight, then you will be falsely directed. By your nature, you will have to be engaged in warfare.
My God, he is telling here, Krishna is telling Arjuna, if you don't fight here now on my order, you'll go and fight with somebody else. Better fight now. Because it is your nature to fight. And in the past, you have done so many battles. Do you think in the future you'll want to fight? Somewhere you'll fight. Better fight now because I'm ordering you. So this is very, very clear instruction Krishna is giving. Later he'll give very clear instruction after some time. Right? Sabhava jena kaunteya nibandha svena karmana kartum nichyasi yan mohat karishyasi avashopitat. Right? Now you don't want to give up, do your duty of fighting, but in the future, surely you will end up doing the fighting. Better do it now on my order. Because I'm here taking care. You do it on my order, you will get success. So then he says, Ishvara Sarva Bhutanam. Riddesh Arjuna Tishtati. Brahmayan Sarva Bhutani. Yantra Rudhani Mayaya.
The Supreme Lord is situated in everyone's heart, O Arjuna, and is directing the wandering of all living entities who are seated as on a machine made of a material energy.
See, Krishna is telling here, see, Lord is sitting in your heart. Actually, he is only sitting in the heart as Paramatma. Lord is sitting and he knows everything and is directing. So kindly listen to his order. If you listen to the order of Paramatma, you will be not affected by any karma. Just listen to him and work on his order, he says. So this is verse number 61. Then he says, because Lord is there in your heart, surrender to him. Okay. This is verse number 62. Tameva sharanam gaccha. Sarva bhavena bharata. Tat prasadat param shantim. Sthanam prapsyasi shashvatam. So the Lord who is in your heart, tam, means Ishvaraha in your heart, sharanam, surrender to him, sarva bhavena, with all your heart, tat prasadat, by his mercy, param shantim, you will attain param shanti, sthanam prapsyasi shashvatam, and you will attain the eternal place, the spiritual world. You'll be liberated from this temporary world. So Krishna is telling this here. So after saying this, you'll see verse number 63. Krishna says, this guhyat guhyataram maya. This knowledge which I have told you now, it is very confidential or more confidential. Vimrishetad asheshena yathichisi tatha kuru. So I have told you many things now, which is very confidential knowledge. Now think about it. Vimrishya means meditate on it, contemplate on it. And then yatha ichasi, whatever you want, you do. So it's very interesting. See, Krishna has given a 1 hour talk. And after giving the 1 hour talk, he's telling, now you do whatever you want. See, so detached Krishna is. He's not forcing Arjuna to follow him. He's giving him the free will. He's giving respecting his free will. And then telling him, you do whatever you like is best for you. So in this way, Krishna ends his talk here in one sense. Because he gave the conclusion now, okay, you do whatever you want. Now Arjuna is wondering, you told this, you told that, you said that work is full of faults, but still you said you should do your work. Then you said work in the spirit of detachment. And I'm a Kshatriya, my duty is to fight, but I'm not liking to fight, but still you told you fight on my order. Like this is thinking, time is going and Krishna is wondering what he's going to do now. Then Krishna, great compassion awakens in his heart. He feels, what if Arjuna makes a wrong choice? What if he still decides, because of his weakness of his heart, if he still decides that I want to go to the forest, I'll not fight, what will happen? So then Krishna continues speaking for next couple of verses. We'll see what are those verses which are coming out of Krishna's heart, out of compassion for Arjuna, which is the conclusion of Bhagavad Gita. He says, 64th verse onwards, he says, now Arjuna, just listen to me now. I'm going to tell you the final thing. Just listen here. So what is that last thing? So it is given in 64, 65, 66, three verses. You will understand the final desire of Krishna. And if you have not understood anything in Bhagavad Gita till now, just try to understand these three verses. And then you will understand the conclusion of Bhagavad Gita. Okay, are you ready? So, this last three verses, which Krishna concludes. Sarva guhyatamam bhuya.
Sarva guhyatamam bhuya.
So, bhuya means, again, I'm going to tell you. Sarva guhyatamam, most confidential knowledge. Please hear it again. Why again? Because I have spoken it before, but you have not understood. So I'm going to tell it again. The final thing I'm going to tell you again now. Please listen. Shrunu me paramam vacha.
Shrunu me paramam vacha.
Paramam vacha. My topmost instruction. Please listen. Ishto si me dridamiti.
Ishto si me dridamiti.
Because you are very dear to me. Ishto si me. Dridamiti. With great conclusion, I'm telling you. Tato vakshami te hitam.
Tato vakshami te hitam.
So I'm going to tell you for your benefit. So kindly listen. 65th verse. It is repeated again in Bhagavad Gita. It was there in 9.36. And again, I think 9.34. Again it is repeated here. Manmana bhava madbhakto.
Manmana bhava madbhakto.
Madhya jimam namaskuru.
Madhya jimam namaskuru.
Mame vishyasi satyam te.
Mame vishyasi satyam te.
Pratijane priyosime.
Pratijane priyosime.
Please read this.
Always think of me, become my devotee, worship me, and offer your homage unto me. Thus you will come to me without fail. I promise you this because you are my dear friend.
Yeah. Manmana, think of me always as Shyam Sundar Krishna. Think of my pastimes and think of all my wonderful qualities. Manmana. Bhava mad bhakto, become a devotee. Chant my holy names, hear my glories. So in this way, become a devotee. Madhyaji, you worship me. Oh, Arjuna, take chamar, take lamp, take the peacock feather and worship me. Become a pujari. Or if you're going to do that, do my namaskar to me. Offer obeisances to me. In this way, you will come to me. Because you're very dear to me, you'll come to me, Krishna tells. After telling this, Krishna gives ultimate order, which is the ultimate conclusion of Bhagavad Gita. If you don't understand any other verses, just try to understand this one shloka, which is called as Paribhasha Sutra of Bhagavad Gita, the ultimate declaration of Bhagavad Gita. Every book which is written, every shastra has got a Paribhasha Sutra, which is the ultimate conclusive statement of that book. Like in Srimad Bhagavatam, the conclusive statement is given in 1.3.28, Bhagavatam's ultimate shloka. It says that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Ete chamsha kalapumsha krishnastu bhagavan swayam indrari vyakulam lokam ridayanti yuge yuge. Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. That's the ultimate shloka. And in Bhagavad Gita, this is the ultimate shloka. So kindly repeat after me. Sarva dharman parityajya.
Sarva dharman parityajya.
Mamekam sharanam braja.
Mamekam sharanam braja.
Aham tvam sarva papebhyo.
Aham tvam sarva papebhyo.
Moksha ishyami ma shuchaha.
Moksha ishyami ma shuchaha.
Please read.
Abandon all varieties of religion and just surrender unto me. I shall deliver you from all sinful reactions. Do not fear.
Yeah. Sarva dharman parityajya. Whatever doubts you have, whatever faiths, other faiths you have, give it up. Sarva dharman. Don't worry about sins. Don't worry about what your family will think. Don't worry about social opinions. Don't worry about anything. Just give up. Sarva dharman parityajya. Mam ekam sharanam vraja. Surrender unto me. Aham tvam sarva papebhyo. See, Arjuna may be thinking, okay, Krishna, you're telling me give up everything and surrender to you and fight? But I'll kill so many people. Sins will come. What will happen to that? Don't worry. Aham tvam sarva papebhyo mokshayishyami. I will take care of all those sinful reactions. You don't worry. Ma suchaha, don't fear, he says. So one may fear actually to practice Krishna Bhakti very seriously. What will my family members think? What will my friends think? What if I go to office with Mithili? What will others think? So one may have so many doubts and apprehensions and other things. And Krishna says here, don't worry. Surrender. Just do whatever I say and he will take care. So Krishna is telling here this ultimate statement, right? Acharyas also explain that if all the people in all the universe give up all their work and just do manmana bhav mad bhakto madhyaji mam namaskuru mam eva shasi satyam teno. So if they just do service to Krishna, still nothing is, no problems will be there. Everybody will be maintained. Krishna will provide for everybody. If everybody in the world gives up whatever they're doing right now and just worships Krishna, still everybody will be happy. That's a promise here. Sarva dharman parityajya mamekam sharanam vraja. But the point is, people cannot have faith in this statement. They have doubts. How is it possible? Just by sitting and chanting Hare Krishna, everything will happen? It will happen if you have faith. Just we should develop this faith and then surrender to Krishna. So then we can experience Krishna's reciprocation. So that's what this shloka says. Okay, so very important shloka. Maybe you can read the purport later. It's very interesting. Then Krishna continues saying that, don't tell this to those who are not austere and not devotees and those who don't want to hear from me. Don't tell these things, he says. Okay, because they cannot understand this sarva dharman parityajya. Let them do whatever they're doing and slowly bring them to bhakti. I'm telling to you because you can surrender to me. You are my devotee. You have faith in me. So that's why he's telling to Arjuna. This confidential statement should not be spoken to unfaithful people, he says. So then he says, then Arjuna asks, whom can I tell this to? Is there anybody worthy of listening to this? Yes, bhaktas. You can tell this to devotees. All those devotees who have faith in me as Supreme Lord and those who have faith in my words, you can tell them this. Just surrender to me. Don't do anything else. I will take care of them. So you tell this to them. Achha, okay. So then next statement Krishna says, kindly repeat this. Nachatasman manushyeshu.
Nachatasmat manushyeshu.
Kaschin me priyakrittamaha.
Kaschin me priyakrittamaha.
Bhavitam nachametasmat. Anya priyataro bhuvi. Please read this.
There is no servant in this world more dear to me than he, nor will there ever be one more dear.
Means a person who speaks Bhagavad Gita to others and makes them understand Gita, he becomes very dear to Krishna. One who is preaching this message of Krishna becomes very dear to Krishna. So Srila Prabhupada, he tells in the purport that why only devotees? We can discuss with others also. Right? And here he says, and I declare that he who studies this sacred conversation of ours worships me by his intelligence. Means if you are studying Gita with sincerity, then you are worshipping Krishna with your mind. Sorry, not mind, intelligence, buddhi. So in this way, reading Gita is also a worship of Krishna. Krishna himself says in Gita. So here, 71 says, those who with faith and who are non-envious, they hear this Bhagavad Gita. Shraddhavan anusuyascha shruniyad api yonaraha sopi mukta shubhal lokan prapniyat punya karmana. Because they are innocent, they hear this Bhagavad Gita, they'll go to punya karmana. They go to places where there are pious people living. So you'll go to that place. So Prabhupada writes here. Yeah. Can you please read this much statement? Yeah.
In the 67th verse of this chapter, the Lord expressly forbade the Gita's being spoken to those who are the envious of the Lord. In other words, Bhagavad Gita is for the devotees only. But it is so happened that sometimes a devotee of the Lord will hold upon a class, and in that class, not all the students are expected to be devotees. Why do such a person hold open a class? It is explained here that although not everyone is a devotee, still there are many men who are not envious of Krishna.
Yeah. They have faith in him as the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So there are some people who may not be envious, but they have faith in Krishna. To them we can give. Like we are holding Zoom classes, we are holding YouTube classes, and many people here. But those who are non-envious, they will only listen. Envious people will not come to such classes. So those innocent people, they will get benefit and they will advance in Krishna consciousness. That's why a person who spreads the message of Gita to others becomes very dear to Krishna. So that's why in December month, Gita Jayanti month, we do so many programs on Bhagavad Gita, so many courses. Like we are also doing this Kannada course and hundreds of people are attending. So why? Because this is what Krishna wants. Spread Gita message. And there are some people who cannot give classes on Gita, but they will help support distributing Gitas. Like many people come to our temple, they take books, 10 books, 20 books, and they go and distribute and give this Gita message to others. And there are some people who cannot even distribute. They don't have time. What they do? Okay, they say, Prabhuji, I'll give this much book sponsorship. You go and distribute it to others. So like this, there are different categories of people. Some who actually go and speak Gita. Those who cannot speak Gita, they go and distribute Gita. Like yesterday morning, we had gone to temple, nearby our temple area. And just within 1 hour, 15 people took Bhagavad Gita's. We are going on Harinam Sankirtan, doing Kirtan, and then calling people. And then they came and immediately took about 17 Gitas. And then about 100 magazines of back to God. So in this way, we distribute and innocent people get benefited. So this is how a preacher or a devotee should try to spread this message. Some or the other, spread this message. So in this way, Krishna asks, Arjuna, did you understand? What did I say? Are your doubts smashed? I have got back your intelligence. Do you know what to do now? Then Arjuna says, yes. Krishna, after hearing your words, all my doubts are smashed. Please read this. Arjuna Vacha.
Arjuna Vacha.
Nashto Moha Smritir Labdha.
Nashto Moha Smritir Labdha.
Tat Prasad Anmayachuta.
Tat Prasad
Anmayachuta.
Mayachuta.
Stitosmi Gata Sandeha.
Stitosmi Gata Sandeha.
Karishye Vachanam Tava.
Karishye Vachanam Tava.
Yeah, Nashto Moha. My illusion is smashed. Smritir Labdha, my intelligence has come back. Tvat Prasada, and by your mercy, hey Achyuta. See, in the beginning, in the first chapter, Krishna was addressed as Achyuta, infallible. And again, he is addressing him as Achyuta. Because of you, I did not fall down. I am still stable. Stitosmi Gata Sandeha. I am standing here without any doubts. See, in the first chapter, he was telling, my head is reeling, I am not able to stand. But now he's telling, I'm standing without any sandeha. Karishya vachanantava. I will do whatever you say, Krishna. So in this way, Arjuna concludes Bhagavad Gita here. And now, last five verses, Sanjay is telling. He's telling that after hearing this discussion, see, Sanjay is telling to Dhritarashtra, hearing this discussion, iti aham vasudevasya parthasya cha mahatmanaha samvadam idam Ashrosham, Adbhutam, Romaharshanam. My hairs are standing on hand. I'm feeling Romancha by hearing this conversation, he says. He's so excited. Then he says, Vyasa Prasada Shrutavan. I am hearing this because of blessings of my Guru Vyasa. Etad Guhyam Aham Param Yogam Yogeshwarat Krishnat Sakshat Katayata Swayam. Krishna is speaking personally about his yoga system. So I'm so fortunate, he's feeling. And he's expressing his gratitude to Vyasadeva. So, right, we should be very grateful to whoever is helping us understand this message of Bhagavad Gita, right? So then he says, I want to hear this again and again. Rajan samsrutya samsrutya samvadam idam adbhutam keshavarjuna yopunyam rishyam ichamuhurmuhum. When I'm remembering these verses of Bhagavad Gita, I'm feeling ecstasy again and again. That's what he's telling. So similarly, when you read Gita, like once you have heard Gita now, you again go back from first chapter and again read. You'll get newer pearls revealed from Bhagavad Gita. Pearls of wisdom and realizations will be revealed. So it's an amazing book. Again and again you can read. So that's why you should have a copy of Bhagavad Gita, a physical copy from which you can read once and twice and again. In soft copy, it is not so easy to read Bhagavad Gita. You should have a hard copy and then you can write some notes. I've written so many notes here and I refer to it and then I share it. Then I hear from somebody, I get more information, more pearls, I write it down here. So in this way, our knowledge and realization gets enhanced. So then he says, Tatcha sansrutya sansrutya rupam atyadbhutam harer Vismayome Maharajan Hrishyamicha Puna Puna. And whenever I remember Krishna's form, I am getting ecstasy again and again. Right? So, and then he says, the last sloka of Bhagavad Gita. Kindly repeat. Everybody can repeat wherever you are. Of course, only Omkar can keep the mic on. Others can also repeat. Yatra Yogeshwara Krishna.
Yatra Yogeshwara Krishna.
Yatra Partho Dhanurdharaha.
Yatra Partho Dhanurdhara.
Tatra Shrir Vijayo Bhutir.
Tatra Shrir Vijayo Bhutir.
Dhruva Nitir Matir Mama.
Dhruva Nitir Matir Mana Mama.
Yeah. Please read this.
Wherever there is a Krishna, the master of all mistakes, and wherever there is the Arjuna, the supreme archer, there will also certainly be opulence, victory, extraordinary power, and morality. That is my opinion.
Yeah. Yatra Yogeshwara Krishna. Krishna is the master of all the yogis, or all the yogic powers are in him. So when Yogeshwara is there, why to worry? Success will be there. And Yatra Partha Dhanurdharah, he is holding his Gandiva. And who can stand in front of him in warfare? He can defeat anybody in the warfare. Tatra, at that place, Srihi means there will be opulence. Vijaya means victory. And then Bhuti, Bhuti means exceptional power. Dhruva Niti, there will be Niti, morality. Matir Mama. So this is my conclusion. Whose conclusion? Sanjaya's conclusion. It is not Krishna's or Arjuna's conclusion. It is Sanjaya's conclusion, a third party. So Sanjaya is telling Dhritarashtra, listen Dhritarashtra, victory is going to be on Pandava's side. Give up this war now. Stop this war. But he is not listening. So Dhritarashtra still feels confident. Oh, we are 100, Pandavas are 5. Surely we will win. So in that way he is thinking. And you will see that ultimately they will be vanquished. So in this way, the Bhagavad Gita concludes by telling that anybody yesham pakshe janardana, jayastu pandu putranam yesham pakshe janardana, wherever Krishna is there, surely there will be victory. So Bhagavad Gita tells us to be on Krishna's side always. Just try to follow the orders of Krishna, orders of spiritual master, and in that way the victory will be ours. So this is the conclusion of Bhagavad Gita. So, and by this we also conclude this Bhagavad Gita course. And then we will have this. So just before concluding, we want to say that next 23rd is Gita Jayanti. 25th Friday is Gita Jayanti. So it's a wonderful day. So we can have a wonderful time. It's a holiday also. And if any one of you want to come to temple, it's a wonderful chance. So you can participate in the programs. It's a whole day program. You can come anytime. And morning, we have Yajna, Gita Yajna, between 8 to 10. And after that, we'll also have Bhagavad Gita recitation, all the 700 shlokas from morning 10 to 4. And in the evening, again, we'll have only 2 chapters recitation, shloka number, chapter number 12 and 15. So if you wish, you can participate. If you cannot come, then you can try to be online. We'll be trying to broadcast at least the morning and evening program online. And we're trying to do the whole day program also if possible. Let's see if possible, we can do it. So in this way, we can try to spend. Fortunately, this time it's a holiday. Generally, Gita Jayanti is not a holiday. But hopefully in the future, it will become an international event. We don't want it to be a holiday, but this event should be celebrated. And even if colleges are there, schools are there, everybody can recite Gita in their schools and colleges. So in this way, we can commemorate Bhagavad Gita Jayanti. So, and if you want to participate in this Gita distribution, so you can inspire your friends and relatives to have a copy of Gita. At least one person can have a copy of Gita on this Gita Jayanti day. Either you can gift it or you can inspire them to buy it. In some or the other, help spread this knowledge to Gita. So it is said that a stagnant pond, the water gets rotten. Right? So there are some wells, we don't use water from that. And what happens? The water becomes stagnant. And then it becomes gas starts coming from it and you cannot use it anymore. It becomes bad. So similarly, the knowledge also which we have acquired, if you don't use it, it will get spoiled. Means we cannot use it. So that's why we should keep it fresh. How to keep it fresh? We should keep revising it, reading it again and again. And not only reading it, but also we should try to speak it to others, share it with others. Right? Maybe you can make a small circle of your friends or those who are interested. It may be 2 people, 3 people, or it can be more people. So you can make a circle and discuss at your own time. Like many of our temple devotees, congregation devotees also, they have their small circles where they keep discussing certain things. They learn from somebody and they discuss. Because by sharing, what happens? Your knowledge remains fresh and your knowledge gets enhanced. So that should be the goal of these sessions. So, and then when you have any doubts, you can again come back to us. We can discuss, we can clarify the doubts, and again, you can go and share with them. So in this way, the chain remains continued. Each one teach one while being taught by one. That's our philosophy. Our learning never ends. Even I am learning from my teachers. And if I have some doubts, I also consult some teachers who are my gurus. So each one teach one while being taught by one. So in this way, the chain continues. This is called as parampara. Let it go on and on and on. So, and if you are mothers, you can teach to your children what you have learned here. And if you are a student or a youth, you can inspire other youths to take to this consciousness, to this Krishna consciousness movement, or maybe connect them to the programs. In this way, you can help in this service. Okay. So with this, we'll conclude here. So there are some questions coming. Prabhuji, what if we distribute Gita, but the person on the other hand doesn't read it? It's not a problem. Okay. Our duty is to give. In future, sometime he may read. There are some people who purchased Gita 20 years back and never touched it. It was lying there somewhere in the library and never touched it. They became old and some of their children got this book. While cleaning the library, they got this book and then out of curiosity started reading and he became a devotee. So we don't know who becomes a devotee. So Prabhupada said, my books are like time bombs. Okay, so you drop a time bomb, like you take a book and give it to somebody, you're like a time bomb. Clock is ticking, tick, 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 tick. When it will explode, you don't know. So when the Krishna Bhakti will awaken, we don't know. But our duty is to give and inspire him. Okay, try to read or attend classes. So if he does it, he may get benefit right now, or else somebody else will read it and somehow they'll get connected. Right? So we can just give it. Pratik Purudas Singh, could Sanjay also see the Vishwarup form? Yes, he saw. In the 11th chapter, we are describing to Dhritarashtra what Arjuna is seeing. So Sanjay also got the vision of seeing Vishwarupa. Not only Arjuna, but those who were devatas, they could see it. And Sanjay could also see it. Selected people could see, not all soldiers could see. Anuradha Mathis asking, can you please tell again about 12th and 15th chapter Gita recitation? We were planning to have it at 6 p.m. in the evening. Everybody in the world, all Hindu organizations will plan to have this Gita recitation at 6 p.m. So we'll send a more notice about this very soon. So we can connect. Because there's very small chapters, 20 shlokas each. So total 40 shlokas. If you recite continuously, it will not take more than 15-20 minutes. So we want everybody to participate in recitation. If we take 18 chapters, it's so long. Some people may get scared, oh, so long. But only 20 shlokas, so it's very easy to recite. Anybody can recite. So that's why we are choosing those shlokas, those chapters. It's mainly for new people. I could not find chapter 17 because I could not send because I was very busy. I could not send the questions. So I'll send it this week. So you can attempt both 17th and 18th. Okay. And I also would request all the devotees, whatever shlokas you have memorized, at least one shloka from each chapter. You can take your phone and then first make a list of shlokas which you want to recite. And we have by hearted. Then just recite it in the phone and put it in the telegram. Okay. Is it possible? Just like I recite shlokas and put it in the telegram for you. No, you have to do it.
Yes, Prabhuji.
Okay. Just recite. At least some 18 shlokas and then or whatever you have memorized, you just recite and then put it in this week. Okay. Okay. By this weekend, you can try to put all those audios. Okay. And we'll meet again next weekend at same time, 5 o'clock, and we'll take further question answers and then some revision of Bhagavad Gita. Okay. And then we'll also say what next. Now Bhagavad Gita is over, then what next? So that we'll discuss next week. Okay? Yeah.
Prabhuji, can you teach us Srimad Bhagavatam?
Yeah, many people are requesting. Let's. I'll take opinions from all of you also. What courses you want to attend. But generally, when we take classes, Srimad Bhagavatam inevitably comes. Right? So it is very... Even when we discuss Bhagavad Gita, it's based on Srimad Bhagavatam only. So we have some courses. I'll tell you about the courses next week. and we'll launch a new course for this batch, which will be more thematic. What we studied Bhagavad Gita right now was more systematic, but it'll next course will be more thematic, which will be better for practical application. We'll take one theme, one verse, and go deep in Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam, and connected stories from Bhagavatam and Puranas, and discuss more practical things for our life. And this 18-chapter course is more theoretical, but in that course, it will be more practical and thematic. Okay, I'll tell more about this next Sunday. Okay. Okay, Shivani Mataji is telling, yes, Guru, I also want the sessions for the same. Yeah. So more important is practical application. Okay, then, thank you very much. It's already 7 o'clock. It is a long session. So we'll end here and we'll meet on Gita Jayanti. And if somebody wants to come, you can contact us on Telegram and you can inform us then we can arrange for prasadam and other things, especially for those who are in Bangalore. And those who are outside, you can go to your local centers and participate in Gita Jayanti. If not, we can join online also. Okay. Hare Krishna. Thank you very much. Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki jai. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.
Jai.
Hare Krishna,
Prabhuji. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna.